Thank you. How's everybody doing tonight? Welcome to downtown. We got a great show for you tonight. I mean, we have ESPN's Bill Patrick with us tonight. And, you know, I was thinking backstage, usually I do 4 to 5 minutes of a monologue, and I figured, tonight, what the heck? Let's skip the monologue, let's just bring out Bill Patrick, huh? He's not that funny. I mean, I could do the 5-minute monologue if you want. It's up to you. Okay. Where's John Hollis, our executive producer, is still on vacation, ladies and gentlemen. So why don't we just bring out the one and only Bill Patrick in a few minutes. So stay with us, and we'll be right back with Bill Patrick.
Last year, the New England Patriots came within one play of making the playoffs, and the American... Let's try it again. Last year, the New England Patriots came within one play of making the playoffs. This year, who knows what... One more time. One play of making the playoffs. This year, who knows? Well, one more time.
Slow with the draw, aren't you, Sheriff?
Name's Holiday, son. Doc Holiday. You know something? One thing that a woman likes around these parts is a man with a slow hand. Listen, I didn't catch your name.
Johnny Ringo's the name.
Yeah. I mean your whole name.
Johnny Ringo Paul George.
Mighty peculiar name for one man. Where you from?
Durango.
You're not running from the law, are you?
Yeah, you might say I had a little problem with the law.
Go fish. Hey, Billy, you're as quiet as a coyote stalking a brown-tailed weasel.
That tooth you fixed is acting up, Doc. Wow, but I'd sure like to pay you back for your services.
Oh, Billy, don't get too emotional.
Well, I reckon my belt does have a few notches from getting upset.
You don't hear your folks in Dodge City. I'm still talking about the time you shot the mailman dead. After your mother sent a birthday card. Hey, you got any jacks?
Dang, never duck! Swear you got eyes behind your head. Broken shaft, you got any nines?
Tote, please, lots of you, me want it.
Is that a no?
Neither, mister. He said little white made a mama boy.
You know, there's something fishy about this engine. You know what they say. The only good engine is Ed Ames.
so many words.
I don't believe we've met yet. Doc Holliday's the name, and I'm the law.
Kick-ass the name, Doctor.
From around these parts, mister?
Rocky Hill, come out here to find me some gold. Got a stake claim in Devil's Gulch.
Devil's Gulch? That's the most treacherous piece of land a man could prospect.
You just saved me a little bit of thinking it's mighty pretty down there.
Oh, oh. Got yourself a score.
Pack mule. Man gets kind of lonely down there.
I always said liquor brings out the worst.
Hey, Ruby Chef! You got any queens?
Well, what'll be, boys?
Well, if it ain't Miss Kitty, the only woman I know who can smell a man's gold from 40 paces.
Well, Doc Holliday, I wouldn't be talking about smelling. You're the only man I know that can feel the pain from a saloon wall every time he changes his socks.
Miss Kitty, your smile can make the meanest sidewinder shoot straight. Whiskey! All right!
You know, Doc, I can't serve the kid or the Injun.
Well, I ain't never known a redskin that didn't like fire or water.
Jimmy, you know Bob what?
He says he'll have a cappuccino.
Cappuccino. Broken Chef, you're one bad mother. Ooh. I'm only talking about Chef.
Well, Doc, let me tell you something. I think you're trying to bluff this old gunslinger. You got any fives?
Ringo, I say go fish. But before you do, give me a 10.
I didn't know you were a God-fearing man, Sheriff. I could swear you're cheating.
Me, Ringo Paul George, coming from a two-bit bushwhacker like you, I take that as a compliment. Gentlemen, I'm out.
What?
Know what your problem is? You wear your cards on your face.
Not so fast, Sheriff. The only thing you get for cheating is a piece of lead in your gullet.
I'd like to string him up for that root canal he gave me last year.
Chef here says the white man is full of many tricks. As you all know, tricks are for kids.
Now, gentlemen, let's all calm down. Why, it's just a little friendly game of go fish.
That's right. Maybe.
Oh, give me a hug. Where the hell are
you? Here and the antelope. That's enough! I'm calling you offside, Sheriff. Besides, I don't know all the words.
Get a good look at this face. Does this face have the look of a low-down, cattle-rustling, horse-thieving, snake-hissing car-cheat?
What was it, Doc? The slow service?
Oh, whiskey. Just a few two-bit gunslingers who try to fight the law.
Got caught cheating again, huh, Don?
Listen, you're the kind of woman that wants to make a man settle down. Raise a couple of kids, Lindsay.
Well, you big six shooter, you. Why don't you count up your earnings? Maybe I could oblige you.
Oh, California. The land.
Okay, our guest, as most of you know, is ESPN's Bill Patrick, and I'm not going to give you the boring details about his career. Let's just bring him out. Ladies and gentlemen, Bill Patrick. Bill, come on out here.
Thank you very much.
Bill, stay welcome.
Stay welcome. Thank you.
Bill.
How am I doing?
Can you come?
Yeah, I can do that. Yeah. I used to be able to. Let's see.
Bill Patrick, ladies and gentlemen, he's here.
Bill, I gotta go now.
Thanks for being so good.
Thanks for having me. I can truly say I've done it all now.
That's right. We had Mike Adams on the show.
Before me?
Before you, right.
That's it. I'm out of here.
All right, so ESPN.
Yeah.
How did you get the job?
I slept with the general manager. and even though he didn't realize it, it was one of these things where it was the last thing on my mind. I ran into a guy that used to be my agent, and he said, "What are your plans?" And I said, "Well, tell you the truth, his name is Bill LaPlante. I said, to tell you the truth, I'm seriously considering getting out of TV."
So you really wanted to get out?
I was considering it because I'd gone about as far as I could go at Channel 3, and I wanted to just try something new. And he said, "Well, would you consider staying in TV if I could get you this amount of money, and you wouldn't have to move?" And I said, "Sure." And the amount of money was more money than I ever thought I'd make in my life.
How much money are we talking about?
We're talking about $4 million a year. No, but it was a lot of money. Yeah. And I said, thinking to myself, there's no way he's ever going to be able to get me this kind of money.
So you gave him a figure of how much
if you could get me that much money a year, I'll stay in TV. I'll do anything they want. I'll scrub floors. Yeah. I'll clean the... So he came through.
He talked. In other words, your agent talked to different sports. Now, did you want to stay in the area, or was it
That's one of the priorities. I wanted to stay in the area. I've got a lot of friends here now, and I count you as one.
Thank you, Bill.
And I didn't want to move, and that was more important than staying in broadcasting, as far as I was concerned. But now I can do both.
So what was your reaction when he said, you know, ESPN wants to take you for that kind of salary?
I passed out.
You did.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. I really didn't believe, number one, that I could do it, and number two, that they really, really wanted me.
Now, when you say you didn't believe you could do it, you didn't think you were good enough to do it?
Exactly, yeah. I mean, you look at ESPN. I mean, if you're a sportscaster, you look at ABC, NBC, CBS, and ESPN. As the four biggies. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in that order. Mm-hmm. Well, ESPN is considered by... By that I mean it's a network. Mm-hmm. It's a network job. Right. As a sportscaster, you can't ask for much more than that. And I never thought, you know, hey, they'd want little old me, you know. So I went in, I auditioned, and the rest is history.
So I mean, you're working at ESPN now as a sports anchor. When you look back in your earlier career, when you first started out, you told me you started out in Maine, and what capacity role was that?
I was in Maine. I was a combination oldies DJ on the WABI AM, country DJ across the hall, WBGW FM.
Are you from Maine?
I was born in Ohio, but now my family has migrated up to Maine. Mm-hmm. I went to Ohio State for 3 years, transferred to the University of Maine, and the whole family's now up there. So I consider myself a maniac. And
they love you, Bill. They love you.
Well, they don't know me. So, in addition to being a DJ on AM, FM, country, oldies, at night after my shift, I would run down the hall. It was a combination AM, FM, TV station. I'd run down the hall and anchor the 11 o'clock sportscast. And I did that for about 3 years.
No, is this how old were you?
I was a senior when I first started. I was a senior at the University of Maine. Wow. So I was... 26.
Did you ever do anything else? I mean, work anything else besides?
Oh yeah, I worked at McDonald's. I was a Fuller Brush salesman.
So you paid
for 3 days.
Still.
I paid my dues, and I'm still paying them, John.
You deserve the salary, is what you're saying.
Oh yeah, no question about it.
So how did your family react to this kind of? I mean,
to ESPN?
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because my folks live up in Maine now. Mind if I take this home?
Yeah, go ahead.
Because I really haven't read this yet.
Yeah,
all right, thanks. Family lives up in Maine right now, and they live in a little teeny town on the coast called Hancock. Mm-hmm. And when I got the job, I was so excited, I called my mother up, and I said, "You're not going to believe this. You're not going to believe it." "What? What?" "I got a job at ESPN.
She goes, oh, that's great, that's great. We're so happy. What's ESPN?
So she didn't know at all.
She had no idea. They don't get cable up there. Yeah, they're getting mail now about a month late. Uh-huh.
Now, did you play sports?
I played tennis in high school. That's about it. Yeah. You know, I wanted to be a baseball player, and then I wanted to be a retired baseball player so I could be on TV.
Now, do you have a favorite sport that you like to cover, or you're not actually going on the field now?
No,
you're
I'm a
sports anchor.
Anchor
stays right in Bristol.
That's it.
At ESPN.
I come in, I write, I anchor, I go home.
You write.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, have you always written your own material, or
absolutely?
You have.
Yeah. Channel 3. It's and all the other stations I've worked for. It's a one-man band.
Funniest moments on TV.
Yeah. Every show. Every show I do. I did a show tonight. We had a reporter at ESPN. His name's Jimmy Roberts. I called him Jimmy Rogers, you know, the Celtics coach.
Right.
You know,
Wasn't he a singer, too?
Honeycomb. Jimmy Rogers. Remember that one? So, you know.
So, do you acknowledge something like that, or do you keep
going? Yeah, you have to. You have to. I mean,
it's funny because we had Gail King on the show, and we were talking about how sometimes newscasters will just go through like it's not even there. And she said she felt it was an insult sometimes to the viewer.
Yeah, I think sometimes you have to. It depends on the individual. I think you do, and Gail obviously does it. But yeah, you can. I mean, you
take
can make
easy.
That work for you.
Yeah.
I do that now, by the way. I do that. Take it easier.
So, funniest moments for you.
Well,
things that you remember that really stand. I mean, really blew.
Well, there's one that could have killed my career back in Bangor, Maine. And I was also in charge of anchoring the Sunday night 11:15 newscast, 15-minute newscast. Mm-hmm. And I was whipping right through it. This is all news, weather, and sports. It was
so
just one guy. I was doing everything for 15 minutes Sunday nights. So I'm whipping right through it, and there was some story about something happened, an act of God up in Maine, and I said, I got caught between the word town and city, and I kind of combined the two, if you know what I mean, to create a female anatomical simile.
Can you just write it out for me?
Yeah, no,
did
it's
you?
A five letter.
So what happened?
Well, nothing happened. I'm not sure if anybody was watching. Probably not. Yeah. But nobody ever said anything, and I was embarrassed as hell, and I went home and, you know.
So that's probably, that's the funniest thing.
That's the funniest thing, but I don't think anybody saw it.
The saddest thing that, no. How about athletes that you've
met? Probably what I'm doing right now, John.
Thanks, Bill. Athletes that you've met, okay?
I've met them all, practically. Except for Ted Williams. And,
okay. Bill Russell.
And Bill Russell.
What about Ali?
Ali, I met the champ. Mm-hmm.
Was he the champ then, or was
no? But he'll always be the champ, as far as I'm. I met him. Tell you the truth, that was kind of sad. It was back in. It was in Hartford in. 82, 83, mm-hmm. And he was just stopped by for. I can't even remember the reason he was here, but he was in really sad shape mm-hmm. then, and you know he wasn't the Ali that we all grew up with and knew and respected him. He sat on the far side of the room. Reporters asked him questions, and he was speaking like this. He kept saying, "I'm tired. I'm so tired." Mm-hmm. And he couldn't understand him. It was really sad to see.
How about Larry Bird?
Bird, well, of course, the Celtics come to the Hartford Civic Center four mm-hmm. times a year. So yeah, I've met him and talked to him.
Now ESPN doesn't cover their games, do they?
Not yet.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Okay.
But Bird. He's a unique individual. He's out there on the court a full 45 minutes before anybody else or any other players mm-hmm. practicing. Here's mm-hmm. the greatest basketball player in the world mm-hmm. practicing 45 minutes before anybody else even sets foot on the court. Mm-hmm. As soon as the lights go on in the auditorium, there's Bird out there practicing. He's unique. He's not, I wouldn't say he's the most outgoing. He's not the nicest person I've ever met, but you got to respect a guy
dedicated.
Like that.
What about Gretzky?
Gretzky is superhuman. Gretzky's too good to be true.
An athlete or as a person?
Both. He's too good to be true. Someone that good, that talented, that widely recognized shouldn't be as nice and as outgoing and as friendly as he is. Mm-hmm. It's not supposed to happen that way.
Yeah.
How
about Yastrzemski?
Yaz, I met, in fact, we played in a charity golf tournament together out at, in Farmington at Tunxus. Uh-huh. And it was 8 o'clock in the morning. We're all getting set to tee off. Yaz is in my group. He walks out. The first thing out of his mouth is, "Hey, kid, give me a Bloody Mary." And that started his day.
Did you get it?
He wasn't talking to me.
Oh, really?
But,
okay, as a kid new in the business, did you look up to anybody, other anchors, sports anchors? Did you emulate anybody?
Well, there were a few local guys. Mm-hmm. I grew up in Columbus, Ohio. There were a few local guys who I tried to emulate. You wouldn't know their names. Jimmy Crum.
Uh-huh. Oh, Jimmy. Yeah.
Jimmy Crum,
yeah. You've got a sister.
Yeah, one of the Lee sisters. There were people on a local level that I
did you have a mentor?
Dave Smith. Yeah. Yeah, I've kind of tried to fashion my life after Dave.
I thought it would be Mike Adams. Now somebody mentioned that you were...
Mike has had a significant impact on my life. That's true.
Dave Smith.
Let's leave it at that.
Yeah, right. Somebody said that you were good friends with Mike Adams. Now, you mentioned that you were thinking of going into business, getting out of this and going into business with him. What kind of business could you and Mike Adams possibly run?
Can I say that on TV? We're still thinking of starting an ad agency.
Well, yeah. Bill, that just about does it. We got to get going.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for
this
being
has been
show.
Great.
I appreciate it.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, ESPN's Bill Patrick. You want to try to comment again, Bill?
We'll see. Right-handed, though. One of these days, I'm going to learn how to dunk. There we go.
That's him, ladies and gentlemen. Stay tuned, we'll be right back. So I was going to ask you, what?
You see me doing this, take the whole thing in my mouth. You ready?
The pocket of his vest, a cold he did. And a stage, and a tie, took a teller by surprise, and the word spread. Billy the Kid.
Now, let me get this straight. Debbie, you'd like your husband to spend a little more time with you?
That's right, Dr. Hancock.
And you, Terry, you feel as though you'd like your wife to give you a little more freedom. You feel stifled.
Right, Doc. The woman I married 6 years ago is not the same woman that's sitting right here. I'm miserable.
Well, if you're so miserable, why don't you just go live with your cronies?
Cronies? I knew I should have never left Sharon. Those were the good old days. Can I have a little more pasta, please?
Honey, can I have a little more pasta? Honey, can I go to bed early? Honey, can I go tinkle?
I didn't marry a man, I married a mouse.
I'm sorry, did I have too much?
A mouse!
You know, Dr. Hancock, I could have married Chuck Callahan. Now, there was a man that knew how to make a woman feel special.
Goodbye, honey, I'm going out. I'll see you at dinner time.
But tonight's our anniversary. You can't leave.
Come on now, Debbie. You know it's Friday. I gotta go help old man Russell skin some possum. Now, come on, little lady. Don't be selfish.
Sharon was nothing. I'm Chuck Allen.
She was a goddess.
I should marry Chuck Allen.
You know, when my wife and I argue, we always sit down and quietly talk it out to each other. Terry, are you really trying to hear what Debbie is trying to say?
Yeah, I hear it loud and clear, Doc. I have been trying. Last Sunday, I took the whole day off, and I spent it with the wife and kids all day long. Does she care? No.
Well, first up, you'll see number 55 coming again on the blitz.
Well, believe it.
They say they've got to have that outside line.
Look at that.
And what about our quiet time alone together? How many times do I have to sit up at night not being able to sleep?
Actually, you know, when my wife and I have our differences, we try to be as honest and sensitive with each other as possible. We try to have fun. Terry, what do you do to try to have fun?
Doctor, I'm just a simple man. I have simple needs. When I come home, I just like to kick my feet back and just stay home and be gently with my wife and children.
Doctor, he's never home. It's me that's home. I'm home all the time, and I'm stuck with the kids. If I do get a chance to go out once in a while, it's to do what? I get to go out and pay a couple of bills?
Look, what you two are going through is only natural. Would you believe that I've never had an argument with my wife?
Never?
Tell me, when was the last time you two really had fun?
Well, I always thought a wedding night was a great time.
Yeah, that was a beautiful night. Look at this. Look at this. Your sister, $10. $10. The meal was $22.50. She had three of them. She always was a pig anyway.
Oh, well, look. At least my father didn't decide at the last minute that he couldn't afford to pay for the liquor.
Well, our time is just about up. I'm sure you kids will work it out. You know, marriage is a great institution. Would you believe that I've been married 37 years today?
37 years?
And you want to know something? Every day is like a honeymoon.
Oh, Doc, that's beautiful.
Yes. And I just couldn't think of being with anyone.
That wraps up our show tonight. I'd like to thank our guest Bill Patrick for being with us tonight. Next week, John Hollis, our executive producer, will be back with us. And also, we're going to have our special contest winner next week. So until then, this is John Mason saying we'll see you in 2 weeks. Good night.